Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the second talk in this room. And as you can see, the topic, scale your digital operations and build product faster and better by embedding a design system. What we're going to talk about today during this talk, of course, is design systems. So first of all, a brief introduction, a short introduction. I am Joris van der Perre. I'm the practice manager design of Bolt, the digital experience unit of Ordina, as Jonas already explained also a little bit in the previous talk. I'm a designer myself, of course. I'm specialized in digital products and services, both on a strategic and a more applied level. And furthermore, I'm also the solution owner of the Ordina design system solution. And so together with my colleague Dimitri here, we will today indulge you in the wonderful world of design systems. So Dimitri, maybe a short introduction of you as well.
Yes, thank you, Joris. Hello, my name is Dimitri or Dimi. I'm a developer at Bolt. And yeah, together with Joris and some other colleagues, we're part of the task force building the design system.
All right, thank you, Dimi. Voila, so I suggest we get started by setting the stage and maybe give some context about what design systems now exactly are and what is the problem or leads us to this solution that we have created. So first of all, what do we see? From our own experience and what's happening in the broader sector is that nowadays offering a great customer experience across digital channels has become a critical factor for companies that push products to the market, a critical factor for success. So it's really important to put sufficient effort and time in creating those experience in a cohesive and coherent way. And although the benefits are obvious, the commercial benefits are obvious of designing products and services consistently and delivering them consistently to the market, we notice and we see that realizing this goal is hard. And for a lot of companies, it's getting harder and harder to realize this. And we could question ourselves, of course, how does this come? And there are numerous reasons. These are just a few of the most important ones, of course, but products are getting more complex. We see the IT infrastructure, the products that are created are getting more and more complex. Teams are getting bigger, design is scaling, development is scaling, and although scaling means it's good, it's growing, but at the same time, scaling brings certain levels of complexity to the table as well. At the same time, technology requirements and so on change at a very high speed. And let's not forget that today, customer expectations also set the bar extremely high when it comes to digital products and services. We must know that today, digital products have become such an important role of our everyday life. We use it to book a hotel, to listen to music, to pay our bills, track fitness goals, whatever. And the expectation we have towards these products and how they work have become extremely high from a customer or user perspective. And this makes a design system one of the most strategic assets for any organization that produces digital products nowadays. But since we're talking about design systems this, design system that, the question of course is, what is a design system now exactly? And to explain this, I want to give a real life example. An example of something we have all used, we have all played with, we grew up with, our kids might play with it, we even might collect it ourselves. And I think some people might know what I'm talking about already. It's about Lego. And if you look at Lego, what is Lego? Basically, it is a set of scalable components following the same design principles, existing of good documentation at the manual on how to build the Lego models. And Lego is something that is accessible and understandable to use for a very broad audience. Young, old, everybody can understand and can use and can play with Lego. And above all, Lego enables people to build numerous variations, as complex or as simple, you could imagine, you could think of. But everything starts from the same set of scalable and reusable components. Everything is can be brought back to the simple Lego brick. And that is exactly what a design system is. It's a set of reusable, accessible design and front-end components with the guidelines and documentation on how to use them. But that's not the only thing, of course. A design system basically is twofold. At the one side, we have the platform, our single source of truth, like shown on the slide here, our starting point where all the documentation is collected, where all assets can be and components can be accessed and so on. But at the same time, there's a model around it, the model around the design system that makes the design system work and embed it within an organization. And then I'm talking about processes, workflows, and the governance that's behind it and that truly makes it work and make it sustainable to have a design system within an organization. So instead of using Lego bricks, what do we use? We use buttons, typography, colors to build all our different models. And of course, it's needless to say that something like this, a design system, has radically changed and improved the way digital products are created and developed the day of today. Everything has become much more scalable, much more efficient, much more methodical, and it falls much more in line with the expected and recognizable patterns. So we can address the expectations of the customer by that way, of course. So I'm already working towards it, but what are now exactly the benefits of having a design system? We know what the design system is by now. We know a bit how it works, but what are exactly now the benefits of having such a design system? And just like a design system is twofold, existing out of basically an operational layer and a model, a governance model around it, a design system itself, the benefits of a design system are twofold as well. And you can best compare it to an iceberg actually. There are the benefits who are at the surface, which are visible, tangible, measurable, for instance, like the shared design libraries or bringing products faster to the market. But at the same time, there are the benefits that are below the surface that in at first sight are not immediately tangible or are less measurable, but that have a very big impact on the organization or the brand as well. Things like the way design system helps to break down silos between design and development and transform the way of working over time. It's not something that's immediately tangible or measurable, but that of course over time has a sufficient and big impact on the company and the way it works. So if you take a closer look at the benefits of a design system, we see that they are mainly situated in four domains. First of all, we have the business value of a design system. It's of great business value, a design system. What does it mean? It means that products can go to market faster because we use reusable and scalable components. We don't need to start each project from scratch as well. We can always continue from that set of scalable and reusable components. So it speeds up the release process as well. At the same time, we have better quality assurance and governance by having a one shared source of truth. Everybody knows where to find the latest information, where to find the latest documentation, so we can have a better quality assurance. And at the same time, of course, it's efficiency and productivity gains by, again, reusable components, clear standards, and so on. And bottom line, all this reducing in ultimately leading up to reduced cost of both design and development. So of course, a big added value for the business. If we then look at another important area of value, of benefit of a design system, it's the value for the employees. Because what does a design system do? It facilitates an ongoing collaboration between design and development, and it helps to break down silos between designers and developers and help transform the way of working. It improves collaboration, it reduces misunderstanding and frustration. Designers and developers can talk the same language, speak about the same things, and it of course helps to improve the collaboration between those expertises. And at the same time, by using those reusable components, scalable components, same design language, same development language, we remove repetitive and low value adding tasks like designing the same button over and over again, or having the same discussion over what color to use over and over again. So room is created for design and development teams to actually solve real business and user challenges that add effective value to the quality of the product. So the focus can shift again to really doing meaningful, valuable work than just basically reinventing the wheel every time again. And then, of course, there's the brand value. A design system, it delivers brand unity at scale across digital touchpoints. What does it mean? We provide a consistent tone of voice across all channels, a consistent tone of voice in experience, in colors, in visual representation, and so on. And let's not forget, bringing products to the market consistently and with a good user experience, it of course also has a very positive impact on brand value, brand perception, brand recognition. People, when they use your products, they can be sure it's of good quality, it's what they expect, and that of course has a very positive impact on the way people perceive the brand as well. And of course, all this value, all this added value leading up to basically the most important value, of course, the value of a design system it brings to the customer. By using a design system, we can deliver user-friendly, accessible products and services that not only provide added value to the customer, but really help him to fill in the needs he's confronted with. And at the same time, the experience he has on those products are predictable and are cohesive and consequent. So a lot of value, of course, in a design system, a lot of benefits of a design system. But what does it mean for Ordina, a design system now? Well, as we said in the beginning, I'm a solution owner. So the whole aim of this project, of the leading up of this presentation, or leading up to this presentation, was, of course, the work we have done in creating our own design system solution for this topic. And what do we want to do from our solution is basically help our clients build digital products in the least amount of time by embedding a design system and scaling their digital operations. And what we say here is basically the power and the twofold power of the design systems. It's one hand, embedding the design system. It's a platform, it's a single source of truth, it's a documentation, it's a components and so on. But at the same time, what you want to do with your solution, it's scaling their digital operations. It's creating the model around the design system as well. It's helping with defining processes, workflows, a governance model, and really making sure that the design system can be used on a sustainable, on a long-term way for our customers. Now, what does it consist, the solution? Basically, to summarize it very briefly, we have a three-phase approach which we use, where we go from intake to create and to accelerate with our customers. Intake means really assessing the current situation of a design system, whether the customer has already an existing one or he has no design system at the moment, and to really understand what's happening, what's going good, what's going well, and how can we come to an actionable plan to really implement a design system at the customer. We have the create phase, which is really creating an MVP of a design system or improving, operationally improving the existing design system if already one is available. And then we have the accelerate phase, where create is really operation, design, development, creating this first version of a design system ready to use within a company. The accelerate phase is really about creating that model around it, making sure we embed it in the organization, we scale those digital operations, and we start working around the model around it. Furthermore, we have our design system teams, multidisciplinary. And why is that important? Same as a design system consists of part design and part development. The teams that should create it should also be consisting of designer and developer profiles. And then last but not least, we have our own design system accelerator. And what is that? Our own design system accelerator is an exercise we're working on for the moment, which is basically building our own design system. And it's a design system consisting of a set of basic principles, workflows, UX elements, our own best practices from our own experience, and so on. And the importance of this design system accelerator is threefold. On one way, it's a means to experiment, to test, play with the different tools, play with how we design this, how we develop this, and how we set up a design system, of course. It's a great tool to give demos and to make it very concrete and tangible when we speak about design systems to people, to customers, and so on, or to colleagues as well. And also very important, and that's what we are aiming towards, of course, it's a great tool to help speed up the implementation time while working for a customer, because a lot of the initial discussions about tooling, structure, naming, and so on that really make the core of a design system are concluded in this setup. And this, of course, makes it a great tool to speed up the implementation process at the customer as well. So Ordina wouldn't be Ordina, of course. I have given a brief introduction on what a design system is, the benefits of a design system, and what it means for Ordina from solution perspective. But Ordina wouldn't be Ordina, of course, if you didn't show how this is technically put together. So to give you a look under the hood of our design system, I'm now going to give the word to Dimitri. And then I have to stop sharing as well, I think. Voilà.
Nice, there we are. Thank you, Joris. All right, so let's have a look under the hood how the technical details will look like for a design system. We can define a design system or a component in kind of a journey that it follows. We start off with an ID, and in the end, we have a component that's ready to be used in a web application. But which steps does it include to go from this ID until the component is ready? Well, we do make use of different components inside of design library, and also different tools and libraries that we can use to make it ourselves easy to implement all the features. First off, we start off with an ID. This ID is discussed and the requirements are set with our design team. Once our design team has a global ID of how the component will look like, we start creating a design for it. For the design, we make use of Figma. It's a collaborative design platform. Easy for us to collaborate between design. We can create the design over there, and then we can iterate over it until it's set in stone how it should look like, the components. Figma also offers a lot of inspection tools, making it easier to share the same language between design and development during the implementation of the components. And components are ready to be implemented after this step is done. Here's an example of how Figma renders our component. So we can see the button, for example. We make sure that we have some variants of our components. In this case, we do have a primary and a tertiary version of our button with different colors. And we also provide some states the button will have, making it a strong foundation for us to later on implement those buttons in the web. Because we do have now the visual feedback for the customer, for the user, that a button is interactable. And all of this makes a great starting point for our design. Once our design is set, we'll move over to the implementation. We decided to go with web components. What do? They are like components that are ready to be used inside a browser. So they are custom elements that we create, and the browser can render them without any additional framework. This has a huge benefit because now we can reuse those components without having to think about which framework it needs to have to render those components. It gives us like a tool chain that we can use to build those components. So make it easier for us to implement them and making sure we can build our components in a clean and maintainable way. So the transforming of design to code is the thing that happens on this step. Next to Stencil, we also make use of Tailwind to style our components. Tailwind provides us with a set of utility CSS classes, making give us the possibility to mix and match them to create the layout that we want. Unlike other UI frameworks that usually come with a default theme, Tailwind just provides you with a lot of classes and you can configure it and extend it to your liking. It's really useful for us, so we can really make sure that the design and the implementation looks identical and make it pixel perfect. Also, with Tailwind, we use one layout framework, so we can make sure that components will have the same look and feel. For example, with the font size or the spacing, they will look identical across components, so the general look and feel will be the same. Here's a small example of how the implementation will look like. I'll take my laser pointer. We start off with a meta tag and the annotation and the component annotation from Stencil. There we define how we can include our components inside of HTML with the tag. We also link to a specific style file. And we also define the shadow DOM. So what shadow DOM will do, it will create a specific scope for our elements, so it doesn't, our styling doesn't interfere with the general styling of the web app where the components is will be used. Next to that, we define some input and output properties on our components. For Stencil, we make use of props and events. So the props will be the inputs where we can configure the component to our liking. The event will be used as an output. So for example, our button, it will have an event bold click, and well, what it will do, it will emit an event when you click on a button. We do have some logic in place inside of a component, and in the end, we will have a render function. This one will return the template of our button. In this case, we'll make use of the default HTML button. We do give the properties, we bind them to this button, for example, disable states. We also link our events to the events that we receive on the button. And we define a list of classes. These classes are from Tailwind. And as you can see, kind of a natural way, we can define, for example, the background color with all the different states as a prefix. So it's pretty readable for us and pretty easy to build our components in a fast way using Tailwind. Once the component is in development, we also make use of another framework called Storybook. Storybook helps us in the UI development of our components. Storybook will actually just render the components inside of our browser, so we can develop our components while the browser will render them, or Storybook will render them. Next to that, we also use Storybook to give the documentation for design form. So Storybook will generate documentation for each of our components automatically. But we also decided to implement the other documentation of our design system inside of Storybooks, and we do that by using Markdown. So with Markdown, it becomes easy for both design development to implement documentation, and Storybook will render everything nicely for us. An example of a story that we have, for example, a button again. We first define a meta tag for Storybook. Storybook will pick this one up to create a page. We first define a title, so that will be the title of our page. And we'll tell it which component we want to render. And we give you some arguments. So those are the two arguments we saw before, the properties, label disabled. And we tell Storybook how it should be rendered. We also make use, for example, over here, of an add-on for running our design inside of Storybook as well. Once the meta tag is defined, we'll start off with the documentation. First, we tell Storybook how to render the components. As you can see here, we are defining some custom HTML with the bold button tag. That's the tag that we defined inside of our component. And Storybook will pick this one up and render our button. Next to that, we'll give some documentation, so in a markdown fashion. And we make a use of Storybook to render some stories. What the story will do, it will render the components for us. So we'll, for example, he made a primary button. We give you some arguments, and in the end, we'll render the component inside of it. So Storybook will have enough information to render our button. Most of the time, we also provide some args table to display all the arguments that we can use for this button, the one that we defined in the meta tag, and Storybook will pick this one up as well. And in the end, Storybook will render this page, so we can see the title on top, the documentation that we provided, and one of the stories, so the primary button that's been rendered alongside the argument table. Cool. So now is everything ready to be deployed. So in order to deploy it, we're making use of Azure pipelines. The pipeline gives us an easy way to build our components and documentation, and make sure that the quality of our components will be good enough to bring them live. It's pretty easy to set up. We give it a configuration file, and it's ready to go. And after each successful build, the documentation will be deployed and the components will be bundled together and created in an artifact. This artifact will be deployed to Azure artifacts, so that will become available as an NPM package. And from here on forwards, we can start implementing the design components. So the DS web components will contain all the web the components we built. And now they're ready to use to be picked up inside of the web application. And in the end, we deliver this to an NPM package. So a box of all the components together with documentation ready to be used. And this concludes our journey. If we want to create a new component or want to add some additional functionality, we start right over at the design phase. There we discuss what needs to be implemented next. And there we go, each step again in the journey. This is the former cycle, and make sure we can iterate and implement features in a fast and efficient way. And that was it. I don't know, Joris, if you want to add something to it.
Yeah, no, great, Dimitri, thank you. Indeed, this concludes it. Maybe just one quick other sneak peek, because Dimitri is talking a lot about process to create the components. I'm just going to quickly share my screen. Okay. No. And so here all of you can see the actual storybook. So basically the place where all documentation, all information is to be found of our design system. And this immediately, this is what we mean with having a nice accelerator, basically having something in hands. Which of course has a process behind it, as you just have seen, with different tools and different technologies building up to this result. But at the same time, having something like this, something visible, visible and visual and working, most important, is a great way to show this to customers and to also use this for us to speed up our work, of course. And as you can see, this is a bit the strength of a design system. It's not only about a set of components that are described and documented, as I will show right away, but it's also about design principles. It's about how do you get started with design, and how do you get started working with this design system? How do you get started with developing by using this design system? How is the governance process organized? What about roles and responsibilities? What about process and workflow? So as you can see, this is where basically the platform, the operational part of the design system, really comes together with the model that's behind it. And of course, this is only the description. It's to be applied in practice as well. But it's a great way of really initiating this and illustrating what the power can be of such a single source of truth. And then, of course, if you go into design, development, and documentation, this is really where the magic starts to happen. things like accessibility, the talk Jonas just had and Yannick before this one, all the important key principles around accessibility for design, for development can be embedded both on a documentation level as of course in an implementation level throughout this design system. Colors can be documented, the way colors needs to be used, spacing is documented, typography and how to use typography is documented. And of course, we can keep on extending this as much as we want. And then basically, this is where the magic even more happens. There is when you go looking at the components itself, it's where you really have a good detailed overview of what can happen with those components, how to use them, different states when hovering, when clicking, an example of the code, properties, the different versions. Okay, this one is coming soon, so I said it's a sneak peek, but the different versions of the icon, of the button, I'm sorry, button sizes, disabled, best practices on how to create a button, accessibility, and so on. And although this seems like quite an extensive page for just a simple button, we've seen at customers from our own experiences that something as simple as a button, the number of interpretations people can give to it when using it for design, for development, and so on, are numerous. And if you have one website, one product, and it uses 5 or 10 or even more different primary action buttons, it becomes a mess. And it means that a lot of people are putting a lot of effort in designing a simple button, and it's not accessible, it's not designed well, it's not, it has a lot of downsides to it. Instead of going through this process, through this component journey, documenting it like this, we have everything we need to create and design and develop good buttons, and we never need to think about how they should look or how they should work, okay, unless it needs some evolution or anything like that. But you get my point. Voila. So over time, we will, of course, give a much more in-depth demo of the actual design system itself here, because we're still very much in the process of developing it. But of course, a nice preview is always good to see. Voila. If anybody has questions, thoughts, remarks, please feel free to contact me or Dimitri. You can ask now as well. Come to the front, like we did with the previous talk, or otherwise you can contact us through Teams, by phone, by email, or whatever. And I would like to thank you all for listening.